Welcome to the American Hospital Association's webinar for trustees on board orientation best practices. I am pleased to introduce our presenter. Dottie Schindlinger is the Vice President and Governance Technology Evangelist at Board Effect and Diligent, where she promotes the intersection of governance and technology as a leading expert in the field. Dottie researches governance trends and writes and speaks for a variety of publications and organizations. Her career has included roles as varied as program development with the Pennsylvania Humanities Council, Director of Training and Education for the Nonprofit Center at LaSalle University, and Associate Faculty of LaSalle's Communication Department, where she taught public speaking to incoming first-year students. Dottie currently serves on the boards of the Alice Paul Institute and the Alliance for Board Effectiveness. It is now my pleasure to turn the program over to Dottie Schindlinger.
Hello, everyone. It's really wonderful to be here with you, and thanks for attending this session on board orientation. Today, we're going to be giving just a brief high-level overview into some of the best practices for orienting new board members in such a way that they can come up to speed quickly and be productive and effective as quickly as possible. But we're going to talk about this in a little bit of a different way in terms of how orientation should be approached, not just as an activity for new board members, but actually as an ongoing strategy that can be conducted across the entire board. Because, of course, as new board members join the board, the entire team is new. And so we're going to talk a bit about that issue and provide some strategies and best practices to help think differently about the way that we approach orientation for new board members. So we'll provide a little bit of a background, and then we'll provide some insight into some of the main reasons why board orientations can tend to fail to meet their objectives, which really would be to help board members find ways to plug in quickly and add value as quickly and as effectively as possible. And then finally, we'll give you some specific strategies that you can use for your next board orientation program, maybe some new ways of thinking about board orientation, and also specific tactical things that you can implement right away. Finally, I'll leave you with some discussion questions that you can propose to your full board as well as to hopefully your governance committee to really kind of help think differently about the way that you bring people on board and bring them up to speed. So just to get started, let's talk a little bit about the purpose of board orientation to begin with. I think this is something that every board, at least every board that I've ever worked with, has some form of orientation for incoming board members, whether those board members have been appointed or elected to their offices, and whether they've been elected through some type of a general public election or whether they've been elected by the board members themselves. When they come on the board, there's generally speaking some opportunity for them to learn a little bit more about what that job is going to entail, and more specifically, what it's going to mean to be a good board member for that particular healthcare system or hospital. And so if we want to just take a moment and say, okay, what is really the purpose of board orientation? The most common answer that organizations would give would be to prepare new members to assume their leadership role at their healthcare system or at their hospital. In some cases, there's also a purpose of helping board members increase their knowledge level, and in particular, maybe fill in any sort of knowledge gaps that might exist in basic board competency areas. So, for example, I've seen this happen when, you know, someone comes on the board who maybe has been a physician for a long time at the hospital, but maybe has never served as a board member and really isn't totally up to speed on what it's going to mean to be a board leader as opposed to being a physician leader. And so providing some basic skill set training and some basic competency area training around the actual job of a board member as opposed to being a physician leader might be something that the hospital will provide. But that kind of competency-based skill set training tends to be a little bit less common than just basically, you know, kind of giving people a good orientation to what is the hospital dealing with right now, what are some of the key issues that the board is going to be dealing with, and just a review of how many board meetings there are, what day they take place, and just kind of the basics. The least common type of approach to orientation is thinking about the board as a whole and understanding that when new members come on board, the entire group changes. We know this, of course, from team building. When we do this with our staff, we know that when we hire a new staff person to join our team, the entire team reforms. Just having one new member can completely change the outcome of the team's productivity. But somehow, that tends to be the least common approach in board orientation. it's pretty rare that the entire board would be asked to go through some type of orientation program. And partly I think that's because we use the word orientation, which kind of gives you this idea of it's something that starts at the beginning and is only really relevant one time. But what I will argue and what I'll suggest during this session is that orientation really should be seen as an ongoing activity. Whenever there's a new board member that comes in, the entire group is going to need to reform a little bit. And so there should be some opportunities for that to happen. And they shouldn't be haphazard or accidental. They should really be intentional and planned. And so we'll talk a little bit about how you can take that approach to really foster a healthy boardroom culture so that the entire group can effectively do their roles and be as productive as possible. So just to talk a little bit about why I feel this is important and why I would suggest this as a different approach to thinking about board orientation is that quite often we see board orientations not meeting their intended goal. And if we say that the intended goal of the board orientation is truly to prepare incoming board members to be effective, well, then it is pretty common that the orientation program just doesn't meet that goal. What we see is a lot of board members that come in, maybe they attend a one-time orientation session, and then they come to a board meeting and are sort of expected right out of the gate to perform really well. And that's maybe a little bit too heavy of a lift. I think it's maybe a little bit unreasonable of us to think that they're going to walk in the door and be instantly effective on day one. And so we might give them a chance to find their footing, but in the meantime, that board member, keep in mind, is trying to orient him or herself just at the same time that we are trying to help them orient themselves. And so if they come in and they can't really figure out a way to fit in quickly, if they can't figure out what kind of value to add quickly, it might really detrimentally impact how long they want to serve on the board and how effective they're going to be overall. They may sort of take a step back. They may just sort of hang back a little bit and not plug in the ways that could be very meaningful to the healthcare system. So I want to talk a little bit about why that can happen. There are really kind of four broad reasons, and I'm sure there's more than four, but these are sort of four big buckets that you can put the reasons that board orientations don't meet that goal under. First and foremost, there may just be no clarity of the reason for doing board orientation in the first place. There may not be any clear understanding of the purpose of board orientation. And maybe one of those things where everyone says, yes, we need to do this, they haven't actually stopped to take a moment and say why. They haven't articulated, why do we need to do this? What is really the point? Why are we trying to orient new people? What is it that we expect to get out of this? And because they don't take the time to articulate that, they also don't have any way to measure whether or not it was successful at the end. If you don't state goals and you don't have clear, measurable objectives you're trying to meet, well, then you can't at the end say whether it was good or bad. It just was, and you didn't really have any plan for how you were going to measure its success, and therefore you really can't measure its success. So I think one of the main reasons that this whole process can be a little bit underwhelming and not very effective is that we don't first start with saying, what's the purpose of this, and how are we going to measure whether or not we have met that purpose? Then I'd say that the second biggest issue is that orientation is seen as an event, and it's not really treated like an ongoing process, when in fact we know very, very well, all of us, from our work lives and our volunteer lives, that it takes time to get up to speed, that we can't really be instantly successful in any new role. It doesn't matter whether that's a board role, being the new CEO, being a new staff member there at the hospital. It takes time. And in fact, that's why I think a lot of CEOs sort of think about the first 100 days of their tenure as a time frame that's useful to kind of look back and say, okay, I had this set of goals. How did I do it? Did it go well? Did it meet the objectives? Well, if we're thinking about board members, CEOs are there every single day of the week. Board members are not. They might be there once a month or every other month or even once a quarter or even less than that. And so the amount of time it's going to take them to fully get ramped up and fully get up to speed and be really successful in those roles is going to be longer than 100 days. Again, if you're doing something every single day, you're going to come up to speed much faster than if you're there just sporadically over the course of the year. Being someplace even 12 times a year doesn't mean that you're going to be an expert by the end of that first year. So I think it's important for us to remember that. I think we all sort of know this intuitively, but we don't necessarily articulate that and then put that into an action plan in terms of how we're going to approach ongoing orientation. I think thinking about it differently and thinking about it as something that maybe needs to happen a little bit at every single meeting would be a much more useful strategy. And we'll talk a bit more about that in the next section. The next big reason that I think board orientations don't meet their goals is that we don't focus enough on board culture. We know, again, somewhat intuitively and certainly through the research, that a healthy board culture, maybe more than any other aspect, will produce a healthy and strong and effective board. I think Peter Drucker has so famously said that, culture eats strategy for lunch. And I think that's really true, or for breakfast, pick your meal. But that's so true. Culture is going to change things in ways that might seem almost out of our control. But if we very intentionally put into place a healthy board culture, we focus on that, we apply energy to that, and we talk out loud and we say out loud what it is that we want to achieve around culture development, we can have a very different set of outcomes. And so it's unfortunate that we might think of board orientation as being something that is only relevant for the newbies and doesn't really focus on the group as a whole. It doesn't focus on the group dynamics and how those dynamics are absolutely going to change when new players are involved. So I think, again, there's another sort of area to investigate and maybe think differently about when we talk about board orientation. And then finally, I would say, generally speaking, we don't provide enough opportunities for incoming board members to teach themselves. And we all know that we learn better when we have to go out and explore and be curious and ask questions and find information and kind of prepare for something. And yet we don't often give those opportunities to new board members. We don't say to them, here's a place you can go, brief yourself on this topic, and then come to the next board meeting ready to present what you've learned to your colleagues and to your peers. So I think if we were to think differently about that and really maybe not bludgeon our poor new board members with a billion documents on day one, but instead give them a place they can go, some central location, maybe an online tool where they can go, they can poke around, they can look at things when they are contextualized for them, when they are meaningful for them, they're going to learn it much faster and more thoroughly than if we just basically, give them a giant binder full of hundreds of pieces of paper and say, good luck with this. That's not really a good approach to orientation. So those are some of the things that I think can often spell a bit of a lackluster orientation process, for lack of a better term. So let's talk now about some specific strategies that can address those four big areas of potential challenge and provide some specific tactical strategies that you can use to change up this process. So first of all, I think you've heard me mention this before, it's really important to think about orientation as an ongoing process. It's a marathon, not a sprint. And it really should be something that begins even before the board member gets elected. I'm a big fan of providing information to potential nominees about what the board is all about and give them an opportunity to ask questions, be curious, kind of get to understand the players involved, get to understand the context within which the healthcare system is operating, get to understand some of the board dynamics before they even agree to serve on the board. Now, here's the thing. As an incoming board candidate, this is something that I do on my own. I will say that very, very rarely does an organization offer this kind of information to me before I've been elected. And yet, think about it. You would never accept a new job, a new paid job, without knowing a whole lot about that company. I mean, when you go on interviews, you're interviewing them as much as they are interviewing you. You want to understand, how am I going to fit in this role? How am I going to fit in this culture at this organization? Do I have the skill sets that are going to be really useful in this specific context? And will I be allowed to apply those skill sets in ways that are meaningful both to the institution and to me in my own development? Those same sets of questions should exist for every incoming board member. I think for some reason we sort of lose sight of this when we think about board elections. We sort of think about it like it's a completely different animal, and we forget some of the things that we just know intuitively when we're hiring a new staff person. But it really should be seen as an ongoing process. So I think it really is best to begin this before they even potentially are nominated. As you're thinking about describing to people what that role is going to be like, have a clear job description, have a very clear set of expectations, a very clear set of responsibilities that go along with the job of being a board member, because it is a job, even if it's not a paid job, it's a job, it's a very important job. So, and then giving those incoming candidates the opportunity to get to know things like your strategic priorities and maybe a little bit of the context within which the healthcare system is operating, maybe a little bit about the team, some of the things that you're really proud of in terms of the attraction and retention of the team. And here's the other thing. I think sometimes when I see organizations that are a little bit reticent to share this kind of information with an incoming candidate before they've been elected, it might be because there are things that they're not super proud of. Maybe there's some financial difficulties happening, or maybe they've had some difficulty retaining talent for the hospital. But quite frankly, I think it's more important to share that kind of information with an incoming candidate than it is less so, because you want to make sure that the person coming in not only knows what it is that they're going to be dealing with, but keep in mind, people come into board roles to serve for lots of different reasons. Some individuals really enjoy coming into a situation that requires a turnaround. That's something they specialize in. It's something they long for. They get excited about that. So I think it's wrong to have the feeling that, you know, you got to hide all the bad stuff and only share, you know, the good stuff. You don't want to do a dog and pony show. You really want this person to be prepared to be an exceptionally good board member. So being candid, I think, really matters. And then, as I'm mentioning here, I would say as much of that information as you can put into an online repository as possible. Certainly, it could be behind a secure system. You could maybe use your board portal if you have one, or a secure website. But the idea would be you want to give the incoming candidate, and certainly as soon as they've been elected, the new board member, the opportunity for self-directed learning. We all learn better when we are given an assignment and we are asked to go find something, learn something. And quite frankly, we all learn in different ways. Some of us like to have a conversation with someone. Some of us like to read something. Some of us really like to dig deep into the data. We should give all incoming board members this kind of opportunity, the opportunity to sit down with the CEO or with some of the division chairs and just ask questions, just get to know what's going on. And also, we should really encourage that peer bonding. It's a great idea to have board members really get to know one another as people. Keep in mind, this is a group that's going to have to make tough decisions together at various times throughout their tenure on the board. The more that they can get to know one another and trust one another, the better able they are going to be to make those tough decisions and to do so knowing that they have each other's back and that they've built this culture of mutual respect. Even when they disagree, they can respect that each other's opinion matters, should be taken seriously, should be considered, and then when the board makes that final decision, they all have to walk out of that room speaking with one voice. There can be no more dissent once they leave that room. Well, my goodness, that's a really tough set of things to be able to do well if you don't know each other. If you have no idea who these folks are around the table with you and you don't trust them, how in the world are you going to make that work? It's just not going to be possible. So as much as you can do to try to encourage that type of curiosity and that type of peer bonding and communication between meetings, during meetings, and after meetings, the better. And so I'll give you a couple of, you know, very specific suggestions. You heard me say a few of them. First of all, I would say providing some basic information before the candidate even gets elected, giving them one central place they can go to direct their own learning. And then I would say, in terms of this peer bonding, there's a wonderful consultant by the name of Susan Howlett based out in Seattle, who has a wonderful set of recommendations on her website about the importance of food at board meetings, which might sound kind of silly, but it's really not. If you think about how we human beings connect with one another, we often connect with each other better when there's food involved. That's just really true. We have lots to talk about. We break bread together. We share with each other a bit about our backgrounds, our experience, our understanding of the world, our perspectives. And so having a little bit of food at the very beginning of meetings and just a little bit of time for people to break the ice, get to know one another, and just start to build a little bit of trust with each other, that can be extremely helpful. And you can sort of facilitate it a bit by, you know, always reminding people, come to the meeting and make a point to go talk to someone you know the least, so that people are not, you know, kind of pairing off and talking to people that are, you know, old friends of theirs, but they're really making an effort to get to know each other, regardless of how well they already know each other. So I think just doing a little tiny bit of that at the beginning of each meeting can be incredibly helpful. But also, at the beginning of each meeting, you can do something to help focus on culture as well. And one really powerful strategy for helping to focus on culture is to start out the meeting, sort of early in the meeting, with having a board member provide a bit of a story. You can call it kind of a mission moment, about something that they experienced that has to do with the mission of the hospital, the mission of the healthcare system. So it might be that they recently, took a child into the ER, or maybe they have a relative that has had to receive treatment in one of the clinics, or maybe they went to an event that past week, and that event was really interesting, and they got to hear an interesting lecture, or they went to a really wonderful gala or a meal. It doesn't matter what kind of moment it was, but it is important to have, you know, each board member have an opportunity at a meeting to share a little bit of what connects them back to the mission of the organization. And you can do that very easily by assigning people a particular meeting where they're going to be asked to share their mission moment at the beginning of the meeting. And it doesn't have to be long. It can be all of 90 seconds. It doesn't have to be a long story, but it should be personal. It should be something that the person is sharing about, I want to share with you this experience that I had and how it reconnected me back with the importance of this place. And just by doing that at the very beginning of the meeting, and especially if you have it rotate through the board, so everybody is doing this at least one time over the course of the year of meetings, you help to ground the rest of the conversation that's happening at the meeting in that mission. You've made it personal. We all resonate with stories. When someone tells us a good story, that feeds something in our soul. We resonate with that. And so if we start the meeting off by telling a good story and something that's personal and reconnects you back with the institution, every other conversation that comes up, whether it's about the budget or about allocating new money for capital expenditures or whether it's about the CEO evaluation, will already have been grounded in why we are here in the first place, why we do what we do, what is the importance of this place, what's the power of this place, why do we serve on this board as opposed to another board. So I think that kind of focus on building that culture, building that collegiality, building that peer bond is very, very important. Another aspect of focusing on culture that I think needs to be encouraged throughout the year is developing a culture within the board of respectful inquiry, especially for incoming board members. Look, they're going to have a lot of questions. They're not going to know if they ask a question whether that question comes with baggage. They don't know, but they have a question, and they should be encouraged to ask those questions. In fact, that can sometimes be the most powerful aspect of new members is they get to come in and very innocently ask a question that needs to be asked, but that has not yet been asked by people that have been there longer. Or maybe has been asked by people that have been there longer, but everyone's got canned answers all ready to go, and they haven't dug deep enough to get at the underlying issue that really needs to be addressed. So one aspect of focusing on culture is developing a culture where inquiry and curiosity is encouraged and not discouraged. And when a question kind of dives deep, allowing time on the agenda for that deep dive. And look, if it's a question that is completely off topic from the rest of the agenda, then it's totally acceptable to say, you know what, that's a great question. I don't think we have time on the agenda to address that at this meeting. Would we all feel comfortable putting that on the next meeting's agenda? Or how do we want to approach addressing that question? Maybe it needs to go to a committee first and then come to the board. The idea is that things should not just be brushed under the rug. They should really be taken seriously, and creating that culture of not only are your questions respected and encouraged, but they're absolutely critical to the potential of this board to be high performing. So I think those are very, very important. Finally, I would say it's extremely important to give every incoming board member a quick win early on. And an easy way to do, and what I mean by a quick win, is have an opportunity to shine, have an opportunity to share their expertise and their insight and their knowledge with the group. And so a very simple way to do this is to give them an assignment. You can give them the responsibility to maybe deliver a report from one of the committees, or maybe to go and learn about how a segment of the hospital functions, something that the board is going to be dealing with in an upcoming meeting. Maybe go and, you know, have a couple of conversations with some of the key staff members there, maybe talk to the CEO, maybe gather some data, and then come and give a short report at the board meeting about what they learned about that business unit. You know, one of the things that's really powerful about doing this is when you give new board members an assignment, they instantly have a way to add value to the meeting. And they learn whatever that thing is probably better than anything else. We always learn things better when we have to present them to a group of our peers. So that gives them a way to add value quickly. It also helps with their ongoing orientation process, and quite frankly, can also help to orient the rest of the board, because they might think they already know something, but when it's seen with fresh eyes, there might be things that they didn't know that come to light, and they can then learn along with that board member. So giving people some quick and early wins will absolutely help with that orientation process. And again, this doesn't all have to happen at the first meeting. You can give each new board member a meeting to prepare for and a subject to prepare for. And that relates then to the final strategy, which is all of these kinds of activities, the coordination, the blocking and tackling of all of these processes really should be owned by your governance committee. If you don't have a governance committee, you may want to think about looking at your current nominating committee and rethinking what their role is. Or if you don't have a nominating committee, maybe taking a look at the executive committee. The point is there should be one body that is responsible for the care and feeding of the board itself. And so that body, generally speaking, is the governance committee, and they can then be tasked with thinking through how are we going to continually provide educational opportunities at every meeting, not just for the new board members, but for the entire group, so that they can cohesively form a team, rely on one another, trust each other, and work incredibly effectively together. So that should be part of their job, not just, you know, who are going to be the next replacements that we bring on the board, but really thinking through how do we empower this group as a whole. So then finally, I want to just leave you with a list of discussion questions that you can take back to your board and maybe just, you know, start this conversation. If some of these ideas intrigue you and you're thinking, you know, maybe we really could benefit from implementing some of these strategies, here are some discussion questions just to get you started. I think the very first one would be to kind of pick up where I just left off in the last slide, which is, you know, is our governance committee or whatever the name of that committee is for you empowered to do this? Have we said to the governance committee, part of your role is to think through how we orient new members and then how we orient the entire board around team development and creating a healthy culture for the board and creating that opportunity for self-directed learning and ongoing education throughout the year. So think about that. Have we empowered them to do that? Have we said, this is part of your job? And have they accepted that responsibility? And if so, you know, are they actually performing that role? I mean, again, it's good to maybe evaluate the committees at the end of each year to say, did they in fact meet the goals that we set for the committee? This would be a really good one for the governance committee. Finally, how are we structuring our orientation program? Have we thought about it as more than just an introductory meeting? You know, clearly, an introductory meeting should still happen. I'm not saying that shouldn't happen. I'm just saying that shouldn't be the only way that you orient people. In fact, even if you're not intentionally orienting new members throughout the year, they are in fact being oriented throughout the year, with or without your help and intention. They are being oriented throughout the year. So you might as well think about it as an ongoing process. And have we structured that in such a way that it fosters that team building that is really critical? Have we also leveraged tools to help promote self-directed learning? Are we making it possible for our board members at any time to go somewhere and get questions answered without having to shoot out an email or pick up a phone? You know, I really am a huge proponent of this. I think that we could do more to leverage the technology that is at our disposal to make sure that people are able to perform in their roles really successfully. That certainly is true of board members. So what are we doing to make sure that that can happen? How are we helping to promote both new board members and existing board members getting to know each other and getting to know more about the context within which they're working? And then finally, a couple of just tactical items. One is, you know, a really good role for outgoing directors, people that are rotating off the board, is to think about asking them if they would be willing to be mentors for incoming members. It can be really helpful to have someone who is not a sitting board member serve as just a person you can call and ask a question of. So, you know, they do their self-directed learning, they go on the site, they read some things, and then they have a question that they really need to talk to a human and say, hey, is this the norm? Is this how this typically happens? I have questions about the background of this document. Were you there when it was created? I was just curious to know if you could give me some of the context. You know, do you think the context has changed? Is it still relevant? What am I missing? You know, it's great for a new board member to have someone they can ask those kinds of questions to. If it's not a recently rotated off director, it could be a current director, could even be the CEO. But I think it's important for it not to always be just one and the same person. You know, if it's always the CEO, for example, well, that's going to, first of all, take a lot of the CEO's time, or can take a lot of the CEO's time. But also what that means is that incoming board member is only going to get that one perspective. I think it's helpful sometimes for it to be someone who's not so close in to the day-to-day operations of the organization, so they have a different perspective. They maybe have a bit more breadth to their perspective, a bit more of an external view as opposed to a really, you know, boots-on-the-ground internal view. Hopefully that new board member is going to get a lot of that boots-on-the-ground view at meetings from the CEO and the CEO's report. I think this is a little different. This is more of a, you know, hey, I just have a question about history, about how this happens. Is this something I should be thinking about? How does this work? And then finally, are we giving our new members opportunities to shine as quickly as possible, giving them a task, giving them a specific assignment, something that they have to accomplish in front of the rest of the board so that it continues to promote that idea of peer mentoring and bonding and learning, but also gives them an opportunity to showcase the things that they can do really well. And then have something that they now own, you know, some topic that they now own. They will feel really invested in that topic, whatever it is. So those are just some basic suggestions. I would certainly be happy to speak to you if you've got questions about any of this, if you'd like to think about implementing some of these strategies in your own organization and want to ask some questions about it. By all means, feel free to contact me. I'd be delighted to hear from you. Thank you so much for your time. I hope this was helpful.